Okay, so let me just quickly see here. Okay, so a few things. Sorry? I'll tell you what I'm going to teach you. So, I want to encourage you to ask questions. After the Friday class last time, I had maybe about 10, 15 students in my office during my office hours, and after that, they claimed they had revelations, right? So don't be shy. You don't have to. If you shy, not ask questions, then come during my office hours. But by all means, please feel free to stop me and bug me if you don't understand something what I'm doing. There is no point of you sitting here. The whole purpose of this is to help you understand material. So maybe I'm just doing a bad job in explaining. If you ask questions, I can try to do it in a better way, right? Now another, the same people made request saying that they learn something easier if they first see concrete examples, right? So what I did, thing was the Fourier transform. So what I did is I did the Fourier transform of a few simple sequences by hand, right? Doing it step by step, but exactly in the way how the fast Fourier transform would do it, right? And even explained, as you will see, calculated a few things to show the cancellation property and this simplification with using both addition and subtraction and reducing the range from 0 to n over 2 minus 1 only. And so after this, you have, of course, also, so it's done by hand. And there is another example here. And I thought suggest you do, as you are going through these nodes, you might want to have in front of you also the code for the fast Fourier transform, which I thought I put here, but I obviously forgot. Try to see as you go through the calculations to identify which of these calculations are done in which step of the FFT. So in this way, hopefully, the miracle of FFT, would be mystery of FFT, will be resolved. So that's this, the third document in under this section, fast Fourier transform, okay? Now, the second thing I wanted to talk about is I got a few complaints that this is not kind of a material that this person expected to see. He expected to see more of a kind of, shall I call them, kind of more conventional algorithm design techniques like greedy and dynamic programming, which we will all do, including max flow and string matching and all sorts of things. Now, why did I do FFT? Okay, in the second semester, algorithms, right? And I cover one part of this absolutely beautiful book called Networked Life. 20 questions and 20 answers, okay? Now, let us look very quickly what are the questions. And I have to change my eyes, being an old man. So if you look at the question is, what makes, can you see? Not really, oh my God. Okay, I'll read it for you. The top says, what makes CDMA work for my smartphone? Is this a practical question? CDMA on your smartphone? But look at the answer. How do I? Sorry? Do you also hate technology? Okay, look, it's not that important. I'll read it for you. It says, what makes my, CDMA work for my smartphone? And the answer is a bunch of matrices and a bunch of constrained optimizations, and so forth. The next question is, let's see what the next question is. The next question is, how does Google rank web pages? Lo and behold, here is the answer. Oh, God. Is it me or is this gizmo broken? Okay, you see it's a bunch of matrix equations and eigenvalue problems. Next question is, how does Netflix recommend movies? Lo and behold, look, full of matrices and matrix algebra. And continued here. Okay, the next question is, how can I trust, when can I trust average rating on Amazon? And this is a little formula, right? Okay, after that is, how do I viralize a YouTube video and tip a Groupon deal? Lo and behold, all full of math. And if you go through this, literally, all of them. What are the other questions? Let me just read other questions for you. Well, if I can see. Why does Wikipedia even work? How do I influence people on Facebook? How can I pay less for each gigabyte? How does traffic get through the internet? And if you look through the book, it's filled with math. So absolutely all the questions are totally practical questions. And not only that, but these are exactly the questions that are hot today. 20 years ago, it wasn't how Google ranks the pages, right? That's the reason why I was doing the FFT as an example of a reasonably sophisticated numerical algorithm. You see, because of this proliferation of big data and data analytics, it is just all the modern algorithms that are truly important for industry, as you could have seen from this book. They are all math-based. How to do what? I have no clue what this. How is it called? Tinder? It is. Never heard of it. Okay. Well, I am an old man. So the point is this, and I'm really. Look, for me, it would be easier to teach you simple combinatorial algorithms, right? But I would shortchange you because if you want your degree to be worth in 10 years, in 20 years, just, you know, I think this book is really only $50 and it is marvelously written. I'm convinced I bought this one. I think it's about 57, was it? Sorry? 88 now. Oh, good grief. Well, I checked 2-3 years ago, so there you go. Well, anyway, it's worth $88. But the point is this. If you want your degree to... right? You will be shooting yourself in your own foot if you don't learn basic math. Because just like any engineering, computer science is, and software engineering relies more and more on mathematics because the problems we tackle are more and more complicated. We are no longer building word processors and things like that. We have to deal with massive data. We have to aggregate inconsistent data in a robust way. We have to balance the load of servers and whatnot. And all of this is mathematics. So you can turn this, the kind of resentment that the computer scientists often feel towards mathematics, you can turn it into your advantage, because if you know it, you will be putting yourself ahead of the pack, okay? So after this sermon, let's continue with the greedy algorithms. Okay. So, where are we now? The greedy method, here it is. So we will not cover any more new material before the midterm. So on the midterm, there will be divide and conquer and greedy and maybe some basic algorithms that you have to really be able to do this. Guys, please. And for the remainder of the time, we will be just solving problems that are related to the midterm. So on the final, you will have only the material after the midterm, okay? So make sure this is your only chance to get good mark on this part of the material, and we will do plenty of examples. And just before the midterm, which is on Wednesday 26th, right? On Monday and Tuesday, I'll have extra office hours so that when you start panicking, you can come to get some reassurance, okay? Yes. It would be greedy, divide and conquer, and maybe some basic stuff that you have to know from before designing algorithms using, say, binary search or something like that. Okay. So, on the midterm, well, what do you think? Why did I teach you fast Fourier transform? Well, FFT is divide and conquer, right? I see you are still deeply in love with FFT. Yes? Sorry? Master theorem, you just have to know how to apply it. That's about it what I'm going to ask you. Okay. Okay, let's see. Now simply practice greedy, and then next week we will also review some divide and conquer, but let us first finish greedy. Okay, given two sequence of letters, A and B, find if B is a subsequence of A in the sense that one can delete some of the letters from A and obtain the sequence B. So let me see if I can add some light to the board. So you have two sequences. A longer sequence A, right? And consisting of a bunch of symbols, and you have another shorter sequence B, and you have to find out whether you can delete some of the letters in the longer sequence without changing the order, so that the leftover is precisely sequence B. How would you do this in a greedy way? Letter by letter, how would you check letter by letter? You don't know. Well, no heuristics. You have to really decisively without, you have to check whether it appears or it doesn't appear. How would you do it in a greedy manner? Yes. Exactly. Exactly. So the strategy is take the first letter in B, find its first occurrence here, right? And map B to this letter and delete all the preceding letters. Then you take the next character of B and you find its first appearance to the right of this letter. If you can find it, you map this into this, and you keep doing that, and if you succeed, the answer is that you find that in fact this is a subsequence. If this breaks down before you finish with all letters, then it's not. Why is this optimal? Why, if B indeed appears here, why this method will definitely find it? Why is this guaranteed to produce a solution if there is one? You assume that the appearance, the embedding of B into A is not by greedy. So it's the same theme. You assume that greedy failed to produce a solution, but there is actually a solution. Well, because greedy failed, this solution wasn't produced by greedy, which means that at certain point, the greedy condition was violated, which means that this had to be mapped, that this had to be further down. What can you do now, obviously? You can swap it. If you mapped it somewhere here, of course, then if there is an earlier appearance, you will, in fact, be able to swap and point this letter to the solution. And if you continue in this way, obviously, you will morph this mapping into the greedy mapping, and thus the greedy has to always produce a correct solution. So it's really simple, and in most of the cases, it's reasonably simple to verify that indeed greedy works. Okay, so here is any questions about this one? Please, if you have questions. Sorry? So assume that the embedding which exists, but greedy failed, that there exists an embedding, but that the greedy failed. Because greedy failed, and this is a solution, this solution couldn't have been made by the greedy strategy, right? Which means that at one point, if you perform the greedy solution, at one point you will get a situation in which this existing solution was mapping this letter not in the first occurrence, but somewhere else. But obviously, you can morph now, you can actually make this solution compliant one step more with the greedy simply by moving this pointer to this earlier. Right? If it worked, embedding it here and finishing off the rest, certainly moving it further, moving it down back will leave you enough space to continue with that solution.
So we are
that's a good question. So we are starting with an embedding that was not produced by greedy, because we assumed that greedy failed, right? That greedy didn't find a solution, but there was, but that there is a solution, and we have to show that this is impossible, right? So because greedy failed, the solution that that maps B into A couldn't have been produced by greedy because greedy failed, right? So this solution is not greedy solution. Now you go from left to the right, and you find the first place where greedy choice was violated. Say this is this place. Greedy choice would map it here. However, because greedy always chooses the first available, right, first available after this match, right? Since A didn't choose this, it couldn't have chosen from the left, because that's the first available occurrence of this symbol. So it must have chosen a symbol on the right. But then what you can do, you can simply drop this symbol and embed this into its earlier appearance and keep the rest the same, because you are just moving this backwards. This will not be compromised. And voila, this new solution is one step more compliant with the greedy. Exactly. It's optimal, meaning just it's a correct solution. It was embedded.
So this is basically
cut and paste. Yes. All of this is cut. Yes.
The solution is shortest first, which finds the upper of the first character.
Mm-hmm.
The next upper of the next character. That is the greedy
solution. Yes. Yes.
Alright, so we assume that it failed and another solution.
But another solution worked.
Right.
Yes. So you assume greedy failed, but another solution worked, and then you show that you can morph this non-greedy solution into greedy solution by making it more and more compliant, it more and more initial steps. Yes. Sorry, can you be a bit louder?
Yeah. The new solution that you're talking about, we say that we are searching for a letter, say C, and we found it like at the first place, and we stopped there, right? So why does the new solution go ahead? Why doesn't it stop at first?
Okay. So we are assuming that greedy failed,
yeah.
Right? So the solution that exists couldn't be obtained by greedy, because greedy failed. Well, if this solution couldn't be obtained by greedy, it means when I go through the letters of the sequence B, eventually I'll find a symbol that was not mapped according to the greedy strategy, right? Now, greedy would map it into the first available occurrence, right? On the right of the previous, right? So since that solution is not compliant with greedy at that point, the only position that it can map must be after that position, because that's the first available solution. So this means if I actually remap this letter back to the greedy choice, nothing is disturbed, and I morphed my solution one step more compliant with the greedy. If I keep doing that, eventually I'll morph my solution into greedy solution, so greedy would find that solution as well. Yeah. Okay.
Sorry.
Yes. Okay. So you see, we want to show that greedy will always produce a solution, right? Now we assume that greedy can fail in some instance, but that there is a solution that greedy failed to find. And we now derive a contradiction, thus showing that if there is a solution, greedy will find it. So we are doing this to show that greedy is omnipotent there. If there is a solution, greedy will. Okay, here is another one. This is what I like. Ask questions and we clear up things, and then it makes sense to go further. So let's keep doing it. You know, this is called inverted classroom or something like that, according to this lingo of modern madness. You have a bunch of stalls, right? And they look 111, I believe. And they look like this, okay? And some of them have damaged roofs, like this, right? And you have to cover them. But this happens in a strange city of Albania, in which there is a law that when you do the covering, you are not allowed to use more than 11 boards. So boards can be as big as possible, but you cannot use more than 11, right? If you think that's a crazy law, just come to Serbia to see what kind of laws we have over there, okay? So the question is, how would you cover these holes with that pieces so that the waste is minimal? Which means, for example, if I use a single piece to cover these two together, then I'll waste 1, 2, 3, 4 lengths that are covered even though they didn't need covering. So your task is to cover all the holes with at most 11 pieces while minimizing the wastage, how much extra material you will use. Sorry? You can use a Kraskal. Ooh, that's. Aha, clustering. That's a very interesting idea. Send me email, you get extra credit for this idea. So look, what a beautiful idea. Idea is, these are objects, my God, that's fantastic. I am absolutely delighted. So look, these, you have to cluster them into 11 clusters so that they are maximally apart. I think this would do the trick. But without, let's try to find a more mundane solution. I love when students come up and, you know, sometimes they really bewilder, you know, the tutors just don't get the, sometimes they come up with, in fact, once. I was trying to find some tough, greedy problem for the dynamic programming problem for the students for the best, for the final. And guess what? One of the students solved it almost trivially with a greedy. and made me feel like, oh my God. Okay, so I want to encourage you to try to solve problems and think creatively, because that's the whole purpose. Look, taking you out of comfort zone is training you for the future, because once you are in the company designing algorithms, there is no one to ask. You have to maneuver to swim totally on your own. I always encourage students to think, even if it's not fully correct, but if it's original and clever, it's worth it. Okay, maybe it will work for something else. Okay, how would you do it in a simpler way, without this ingenious idea with K-clustering?
Can we look for the first point that we need to cover, mm-hmm, and the last point that we need to cover? Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Here it is. This is actually very close to keeping the things maximally apart. I believe it would produce exactly the same solution. So the idea is, that's one idea, possible way of doing it, cover everything with a single piece. So you are wasting lots of material. You want to cut it now into two, so you want to excise somewhere a middle piece. Which middle piece you will excise to save as much as possible? The longest one, right? So for example, if this was not needed, this one would excise this piece, right? Because you will save the most by not covering these guys. And you keep doing that, chopping it into finer pieces until you create 11 of them. Okay, so this is from a single piece going down, right? Now, how would you do it the other way around? So rather than starting with 11 pieces, you can start with as many pieces as you have holes. And what do you do next to reduce the number of pieces? Exactly. Around, you will merge those that have minimal number of spaces in between. Right? So one solution is you start with a large single chunk, you cut out as big piece as possible to make it into two, then from the two pieces you look there what you can cut out, and keep doing that until you produce 11 pieces. The other direction is you cover each of the holes by a separate piece. Now you have to merge these pieces together. Which ones you will merge? You will merge two consecutives that are closest to each other. Okay? So, is this clear? Yes. Yes. That's right. So it might be a bit of an overkill because they are all in one, but the solution is really pretty because you just say use K clustering. Use 11 clustering and that's it. You know how, okay, so a mathematician is given a task to make tea, and he has the kettle and he has the teapot, and he has to make the tea. So he pours water into the kettle, boils the water, pours it into teapot, and makes a tea. Then he is given the second problem: make a tea, but the water is in the kettle. What does he do? Exactly. He pours the water out and reduces the problem to the previous one. So if you can reduce a problem to something that you have seen, it can save you lots of work. Okay, tape storage. You were not born when this was actually an interesting problem, but when I was your age, then What was the language that I had to use to program? What do you think at my age? Don't ask me. Sorry? Well, it was on tapes, but what language was used for, except for COBOL for business? What was the general purpose language? Algol or Fortran. So the first language I've seen was Fortran, without pointers and without. Anyhow, but we had actually perforated cards and tapes, and actually also paper tapes with holes. And the internal storage was on like magnetic tapes, just like a record, I mean like a tape recorder. And so you want to put files. And when you search for the file, the machine actually goes to the beginning and then goes through all the files until it finds the file that you need. Now, some files are of different length, and assume that all files are equally likely to be needed. How would you order the files on the tape to minimize the expected search time? Shortest to the longest. Very good. Because if you compute the search time, it will be just L1 for the first file, L1 plus L2 for the second file, L1 plus L3, and when you sort of clean up a little bit, you get N times L1, N minus 1 times L2, N minus 2 times L3, and of course, because N is the largest multiplier here, L1 should be as small as possible. Now, a more interesting problem. Assume now that not all files are equally likely to be needed, and not all files are of the same length. You again want to sort files on the tape, but so that the expected search time is minimized. Now, you would like to put files that are long towards the end, but you would also like to put towards the end also which files? Ones that you very seldom call. So now you have two conflicting requirements, because maybe something is often needed, but it is long. Where should you put it? Closer to the beginning or? Sorry? No, you have to just one tape. It's an Elbonian computer that has a single tape recorder, and you have to put all of the files on a single tape. What do you think? What will be the criterion? Sorry? Priority? What is the priority? You mean the frequency? But you know, it's kind of conflicting, because it's not only that the frequency so let's see, if the probability is larger, should it go closer to the beginning or further to the end? So a large probability should pull it closer to the beginning, but a large length should move it closer to the end. So what is a function that increases with respect to probability but decreases with respect to length? Well, expected value, it's very close to that. So you have two parameters, length and frequency. So you want to minimize the expected value of searches through the whole file system. So what, yes? Exactly. You look at the ratio between the probability and the length and sort it according to that magnitude. Now we have to show that if we do that, lo and behold, the expected time will be minimized. Assume, so it's the same story. Play it again, Sam. It's the same story. How do we prove that that's optimal? What do we usually do? Well, that's very good. Just try brute force on the midterm and you will see how many points you get. So, yes. Assume the contrapositive. So assume that one of the files has larger quotient, but it has been put after a file with a smaller quotient. Let's call this inversion. Now, what do you think? Shall we look at arbitrary inversions or adjacent inversions? Perfect. Why? Because when you swap adjacent inversions, only these locally things change. Before that and after that will not change at all. Only so you minimize the change to show that it is optimal. So let's see. So here is the expected value. Oops. Probability of file 1. So we are assuming that we are sorting it according to the ratio of P over L. Expected value, we sorted it and we re-enumerated it so that these guys are in that order. So the expected time is then P1L1 times probability to need the second file times the search time for the second file plus probability that you need the third file times the search time for the third file, which is the sum of all three previous, so all three lengths and so forth. So now, assume that, in fact, there was an inversion, right? And that, in fact, an inversion between two adjacent files. So what would be the expected then values? You see, the first one is just precisely what we have written. Right, it's just sums times the corresponding P. But now we do one swap, and this swap happens where? It happens just here. So you see, we swap the file K with file K plus 1. So instead of file K, like here, file K is skipped, and you have LK plus 1, times probability pk plus 1, plus, and then here, instead of having, of course, pk here, pk comes at the end, times probability of pk. So now we have to show that if there was an inversion here, after swapping, the expected time will drop. You simply find the difference between the two, and because the inversion is of two adjacent files. All terms cancel out except who survives here. Well, what is missing here, right, will be P, so it's PK LK plus 1, right? And here times PK plus 1. Right, if you subtract these two, everything cancels out except LPK plus 1. Did I do it in correct order? Let me see. In E prime, we have left over, minus LK plus 1 times PK, because we are subtracting from this expression. So here the missing part is LK plus 1 times PK, and it will be negative. And here the extra factor is LK times PK plus 1, namely this one here that is missing here. And now, of course, this will be positive just in case LK PK plus 1 is bigger than LK plus 1 PK, i.e. when this ratio is in the, is in this relationship. So what do you do? You just write expression for the expected time before swap, expression for the expected time immediately after the swap. Because they are adjacent, everything cancels out except these four terms, which you can easily verify. And then you just see when this will be smaller than that, and that's precisely when this condition holds. So the bottom line why I like this example is sometimes you have to kind of be clever to cook up, to define correctly the magnitude with respect to which you are trying to be greedy. And the proof of optimality is almost always the same, usually counter positive and cut and paste massaging one solution to the other. Okay, so any questions about this problem? Yeah, please read this carefully because all of these are kind of tricks that I will expect you to kind of master to solve problems that you will have on the midterm. Okay, here is another nice problem. So you have a bunch of intervals, okay, that partly overlap, as you can see here. What you have to do, assume that these are posters, and you are very happy with the pins, and you want to use as few pins to fasten the posters to the bulletin board, right? So use as few pins as possible so that each poster is stabbed at least once. How would you do that? Let's see, what is a natural thing? Who is the best candidate to be stabbed? At what point? The one that has the most overlaps. Well, let's see if this is true. You see, it's very easy to have greedy often lures you with a kind of appealing solution that actually failed. Now look at this example. Here is one poster, then two posters. Here are two more posters and one poster here. If you want to stab the largest number of posters, where would you go? Right in the middle, right? But then this guy is not stabbed and this guy is not stabbed. But notice, if you stab here and if you stab here, then you don't need any other needles. What's funny? So stabbed here, but then we needed two more needles. But if I remove these and then just stab here and here, now all of the posters are stabbed, even though we didn't use the most kind of appealing place where to put the needle. So you have to be really, really careful. Greedy is a powerful technique, but very often it lures you to kind of into wrong direction. So this is why a quote-unquote proof, or let's call it informal, is important. You have to simply persuade yourself that your solution is correct. So if it's not to stab one that is the most overlapping, which one should you stab then first? Exactly. That's the same trick as the interval scheduling. You will stab the one that finishes first, and you should stop it just at the very end of it. Why? Because this poster has to be stopped. But if you stop it as close to end as possible, you make it much more likely to catch more others. Then you would remove those stabbed, and again you would look for the first to finish and stop there, right? So it's exactly the same idea as interval scheduling. You see, usually when things are linearly ordered, you kind of go from left to the right, resist the temptation to look at the best spot. Okay. Let's make now, what time is it? Yeah, I guess we can make a short 10-minute break and then we continue. Okay, this one. So here.
Not this one, the previous.
Previous?
Yeah.
That one?
Yeah. And in this one, like, why this K plus one? Okay, I'll come.
Yeah. Okay.
Why this K plus one? Minus.
Okay, so you see, we are assuming that PK, that file K and file K plus one are inverted.
Okay.
Right? So let's see. If this is original configuration, this is the expected time. Now, I want to show that if they are inverted and I swap, the expected time will drop. If I swap, K file disappears and I have K plus first, right? Here, right, I get, right? And now when you subtract, this, what is left out? LK plus 1 times PK, and here it's PK, it is which one? It is, yeah, LK plus 1 PK, and here it's PK plus 1 LK. Yeah. And you just to compare which one
so
is.
So the timing of this should be greater, right?
Yes, yeah. And you see that it's great